The Sacrament of Confirmation. Importance of instruction on confirmation. If ever there was a time demanding the diligence of pastors in explaining the sacrament of confirmation, in these days certainly it requires special attention, when there are found in the Holy Church of God many by whom this sacrament is altogether omitted, while very few seek to obtain from it the fruit of divine grace which they should derive from its participation. Lest, therefore, this divine blessing may seem, through their fault, and to their most serious injury, to have been conferred on them in vain, the faithful are to be instructed both on Whit Sunday, on which day it is principally administered, and also on such other days as pastor shall deem convenient. Their instructions should so treat the nature, power, and dignity of this sacrament, that the faithful may understand not only that it is not to be neglected, but that it is to be received with the greatest piety and devotion. Name of this sacrament. To begin with the name, it should be taught that this sacrament is called by the Church Confirmation because, if there is no obstacle to the efficacy of the sacrament, a baptized person, when anointed with the sacred chrism by the bishop, with the accompanying solemn words, "I sign thee with the sign of the cross, and confirm thee with the chrism of salvation, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost," becomes stronger with the strength of a new power, and thus begins to be a perfect soldier of Christ. Confirmation is a sacrament. That in confirmation is contained the true and proper nature of a sacrament has always been acknowledged by the Catholic Church, as Pope Melchiades and many other very holy and very ancient pontiffs expressly declare. The truth of this doctrine Saint Clement could not confirm in stronger terms than when he says, "All should hasten without delay to be born again unto God, and afterwards to be signed by the bishop," that is, to receive the sevenfold grace of the Holy Ghost, for, as has been handed down to us from Saint Peter, and as the other apostles taught in obedience to the command and of our Lord, he who culpably and voluntarily, and not from necessity, neglects to receive this sacrament, cannot possibly be a perfect Christian. This same faith has been confirmed, as may be seen in their decrees, by Popes Urban, Fabian, and Eusebius, who, filled with the same spirit, shed their blood for the name of Christ. The unanimous authority of the fathers must be added. Among them Denis the Areopagite, bishop of Athens, when teaching how to consecrate and make use of this holy ointment, says, "The priests clothe the person baptized with a garment emblematic of purity, in order to conduct him to the bishop, and the bishop, signing him with the sacred and truly divine ointment, makes him partaker of the most holy communion." Of such importance does Eusebius of Caesarea also deem this sacrament as not to hesitate to say that the heretic Novatus could not deserve to receive the Holy Ghost, because, having been baptized in a state of severe illness, he was not anointed with the sign of chrism. But on this subject we have the most distinct testimonies from Saint Ambrose in his book on the initiated, and from Saint Augustine in his books against the epistles of Patilian the Donatist. Both of them were so persuaded that no doubt could exist as to the reality of this sacrament that they even taught and confirmed the doctrine by passages of Scripture, the one testifying that to the sacrament of confirmation apply these words of the Apostle, "Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed," the other, these words of the Psalmist, "Like the precious ointment on the head, that ran down upon the beard of Aaron," and also these words of the same Apostle, "The charity of God is poured forth in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, who is given to us." Confirmation is distinct from baptism. Although said by Melchiades to have a most intimate connection with baptism, confirmation is still not to be regarded as the same, but as a very different sacrament, for the variety of the grace which each of the sacraments confers, and of the sensible sign employed to signify that grace, evidently render them distinct and different sacraments. Since, then, by the grace of baptism we are begotten unto newness of life, whereas by that of confirmation we grow to full maturity, having put away the things of a child, we can sufficiently understand that the same difference that exists in the natural life between birth and growth exists also between baptism, which regenerates, and confirmation, by virtue of which growth and perfect spiritual strength are imparted to the faithful. Besides, as there should be a new and distinct kind of sacrament when the soul has to encounter any new difficulty. It may easily be perceived that as we require the grace of baptism to form the mind unto faith, so is it also of the utmost advantage that the souls of the faithful be strengthened by a different grace, to the end that they be deterred by no danger, or fear of pains, tortures or death, from the confession of the true faith. This, then, being accomplished by the sacred chrism of confirmation, it is hence clearly inferred, that the nature of this sacrament is different from baptism. Hence Pope Melchiades accurately evolves the difference between them, writing as follows: in baptism man is enlisted into the service, in confirmation he is equipped for battle. At the baptismal font the Holy Ghost imparts fullness to accomplish innocence, but in confirmation he ministers perfection to grace. In baptism we are regenerated unto life, after baptism we are fortified for the combat, in baptism we are cleansed, after baptism we are strengthened. Regeneration of itself saves those who receive baptism in time of peace, confirmation arms and makes ready for conflicts. These are truths not only already recorded by other councils, but specially defined by the Holy Council of Trent, so that we are therefore no longer at liberty not only to think otherwise, but even to entertain the least doubt concerning them. Institution of Confirmation. It was shown above how necessary it is to teach concerning all the sacraments in common from whom they had their origin. Wherefore the same is also to be taught as regards confirmation, in order that the faithful may be impressed with a deeper sense of the sanctity of this sacrament. Accordingly, pastors must explain that not only was it instituted by Christ the Lord, but that by him were also ordained, as Pope Saint Fabian testifies, the rite of chrism in the words which the Catholic Church uses in its administration. This is a fact easy to prove to those who acknowledge confirmation to be a sacrament, because all the sacred mysteries exceed the powers of human nature and could be instituted by no other than God alone. Component parts of confirmation. The matter. We now come to treat of the component parts of the sacrament, and first of its matter. This is called chrism, a word borrowed from the Greek language, and which, although used by profane writers to designate any sort of ointment, is appropriated by common usage among ecclesiastical writers to signify that ointment only which is composed of oil and balsam with the solemn consecration of the bishop. A mixture of two material things, therefore, furnishes the matter of confirmation, and this mixture of different things not only declares the manifold grace of the Holy Ghost given to those who are confirmed but also sufficiently shows the excellence of the sacrament itself. The remote matter of confirmation is chrism. That such is the matter of this sacrament the Holy Church and her councils have always taught, and the same doctrine has been handed down to us by Saint Denis and by many other fathers of the gravest authority, particularly by Pope Fabian, who testifies that the apostles received the composition of chrism from our Lord and transmitted it to us. The appropriateness of chrism. Nor indeed could any other matter than that of chrism seem more appropriate to declare the effects of this sacrament. Oil, by its nature rich, unctuous and fluid, expresses the fullness of grace, which, through the Holy Ghost, overflows and is poured into others from Christ the head, like the ointment that ran down upon the beard of Aaron, to the skirt of his garment, for God anointed him with the oil of gladness, above his fellows, and of his fullness we all have received. Balsam, the door of which is most pleasant, can signify naught save that the faithful, when made perfect by the grace of confirmation, diffuse around them such a sweet odor of all virtues, that they may say with the apostle, "We are unto God the good odor of Christ." Balsam has also the power of preserving from corruption whatever it is used to anoint. This property seems admirably suited to express the virtue of the sacrament, since it is quite evident that the souls of the faithful, prepared by the heavenly grace of confirmation, are easily protected from the contagion of sins. Chrism to be consecrated by the bishop. The chrism is consecrated by the bishop with solemn ceremonies, for that our Savior gave this instruction at his Last Supper, when he committed to his apostles the manner of making chrism. We learn from Fabian, upon to feminately distinguished by his sanctity and by the glory of martyrdom. The necessity of this consecration may, however, be shown from reason also. In most of the other sacraments Christ so instituted their matter as to impart holiness also to it. For not only did he designate water as the element of baptism, saying, "Except a man be born again of water and the Holy Ghost, he cannot enter the kingdom of God," but he also, at his own baptism, imparted to it the power of sanctifying thereafter. Hence these words of Saint Chrysostom: "The water of baptism, had it not been sanctified by contact with the body of our Lord, could not purge away the sins of believers." As, then, our Lord did not consecrate this matter of confirmation by actually using and handling it, it is necessary that it be consecrated by holy and religious prayers, and this consecration can appertain to none save the bishop, who has been appointed the ordinary minister of this sacrament. The form of confirmation. The other component part of confirmation, that is, its form and the words used at the sacred unction, must also be explained. The faithful are to be admonished that in receiving this sacrament they are, in particular on hearing the words pronounced, to excite their minds to piety, faith and religion, that no obstacle may be placed to heavenly grace. The form of confirmation, then, is comprised in these words: "I sign thee with the sign of the cross, and I confirm thee with the chrism of salvation, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost." If we call upon reason regarding this truth, we may also easily prove the same thing, for the form of a sacrament should comprise all those things that explain the nature and substance of the sacrament itself. But in confirmation these three things are chiefly to be noted: the divine power which, as a principal cause, operates in the sacrament, the strength of mind and soul which is imparted by the sacred unction to the faithful unto salvation, and finally, the sign impressed on him who is to enter upon the warfare of Christ. Now of these the first is sufficiently declared by the concluding words of the form: "In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost," the second, by the words immediately preceding them: "I confirm thee with the chrism of salvation," and the third, by the words with which the form opens: "I sign thee with the sign of the cross." But were we even unable to prove by reason that this is the true and perfect form of this sacrament, the authority of the Catholic Church, under whose guidance we have always been thus taught, suffers us not to entertain the least doubt on the subject. Minister of Confirmation. Pastor should also teach to whom especially has been committed the administration of this sacrament, for as, according to the prophet, there are many who run without being sent, it is necessary to teach who are its true and legitimate ministers, in order that the faithful may be enabled to receive the sacrament and grace of confirmation. Now the Holy Scriptures show that the bishop alone is the ordinary minister of this sacrament, because we read in the Acts of the Apostles that when Samaria had received the word of God, Peter and John were sent to them, who prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost, for he was not as yet come upon any of them, but they were only baptized. Here we may see that he who had baptized, having been only a deacon, had no power to confirm, but that its administration was reserved to a more perfect order of ministers, that is, to the apostles. The same may be observed whenever the sacred scriptures make mention of this sacrament. Nor are there wanting in proof of this matter the clearest testimonies of the Holy Fathers and of Pope Urban, Eusebius, Damasus, Innocent, and Leo, as is evident from their decrees. Saint Augustine, also, seriously complains of the corrupt practice of the Egyptians and Alexandrians, whose priests dared to administer the sacrament of confirmation. The thorough propriety of reserving this function to bishops the pastor may illustrate by the following comparison. As in the construction of buildings the artisans, who are inferior agents, prepare and dispose cement, lime, timbers and the other material, while to the architect belongs the completion of the work, so in like manner this sacrament, which is, as it were, the completion of the spiritual edifice, should be performed by no other than the chief priest. Sponsors at confirmation. A sponsor is also required, as we have already shown to be the case in baptism. For if they who enter the fencing lists have need for someone whose skill in counsel may teach them the thrusts and passes by which to overcome their adversaries, while remaining safe themselves, how much more will the faithful require leader and monitor, when, sheathed, as it were, in the stoutest armor by this sacrament of confirmation, they engage in the spiritual conflict, in which eternal salvation is the proposed reward. With good reason, therefore, Our sponsors employed in the administration of this sacrament also, and the same spiritual affinity is contracted in confirmation, which, as we have already shown, is contracted by sponsors in baptism, so as to impede the lawful marriage of the parties. The subject of confirmation. It often happens that, in receiving this sacrament, the faithful are guilty of either precipitate haste or a gross neglect and delay, concerning those who have become so impious as to have the hardihood to contemn and despise it, we have nothing to say. Pastors, therefore, should also explain who may receive confirmation, and what should be their age and dispositions. All should be confirmed. First, it is necessary to teach that this sacrament is not so necessary as to be utterly essential to salvation. Although not essential, however, it ought to be omitted by no one, but rather, on the contrary, in a matter so full of holiness through which the divine gifts are so liberally bestowed, the greater care should be taken to avoid all neglect. What God has proposed in common unto all for their sanctification, all should likewise most earnestly desire. Saint Luke, indeed, describing this admirable effusion of the Holy Spirit, says, "And suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a mighty wind coming, and it filled the whole house, where they were sitting, and a little after, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost." From these words we may understand that, as that house was a type and figure of the Church, the sacrament of confirmation, which took its beginning from that day, appertains to all the faithful. This may also be easily inferred from the nature of the sacrament itself. For they ought to be confirmed with the sacred chrism who have need of spiritual increase, and who are to be led to the perfection of the Christian religion. But this is, without exception, suited to all, because as nature intends that all her children should grow up and attain full maturity, although she does not always realize her wishes, so the Catholic Church, the common mother of all, earnestly desires that, in those whom she has regenerated by baptism, the perfection of Christian manhood be completed. Now as this is accomplished through the sacrament of mystic unction, it is clear that confirmation belongs alike to all the faithful. The proper age for confirmation. Here it is to be observed, that, after baptism, the sacrament of confirmation may indeed be administered to all, but that, until children shall have attained the use of reason, its administration is inexpedient. If it does not seem well to defer confirmation to the age of 12, it is most proper to postpone this sacrament at least to that of 7 years. Confirmation has not been instituted as necessary to salvation, but that by virtue thereof we may be found very well armed and prepared when called upon to fight for the faith of Christ, and for this conflict no one assuredly will consider children who as yet lack the use of reason to be qualified. Dispositions for receiving confirmation. From this, therefore, it follows that persons of mature age, who are to be confirmed, must, if they desire to obtain the grace and gifts of this sacrament, not only bring with them faith and piety, but also grieve from their hearts for the serious sins which they have committed. The pastor should take care that they have previous recourse to confession of their sins, should exhort them to fasting and other works of piety, and admonish them of the propriety of reviving that laudable practice of the ancient Church, of receiving this sacrament fasting. It is to be presumed that to this the faithful may be easily persuaded, if they but understand the gifts and admirable effects of this sacrament. The effects of confirmation. Pastors, therefore, should teach that, in common with the other sacraments, confirmation, unless some obstacle be present on the part of the receiver, imparts new grace. For we have shown that these sacred and mystical signs are of such a character as to indicate and produce grace. The grace of strength. But besides these things, which are common to this and the other sacraments, it is peculiar to confirmation first to perfect the grace of baptism. For those who have been made Christians by baptism, still have in some sort the tenderness and softness, as it were, of newborn infants, and afterwards become, by means of the sacrament of chrism, stronger to resist all the assaults of the world, the flesh and the devil, while their minds are fully confirmed in faith to confess and glorify the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Hence, also, originated the very name, confirmation, as no one will doubt. For the word confirmation is not derived, as some not less ignorantly than impiously have pretended, from the circumstance that persons baptized in infancy, when arrived at mature years, were of old brought to the bishop, in order to confirm their faith in Christ, which they had embraced till baptism, so that confirmation would seem not to differ from catechetical instruction. Of such a practice no reliable testimony can be adduced. On the contrary, the name has been derived from the fact that by virtue of this sacrament God confirms in us the work He commenced in baptism, leading us to the perfection of solid Christian virtue. Increase in grace. But not only does it confirm, it also increases, divine grace, as says Melchiades, the Holy Ghost, whose salutary descent upon the waters of baptism, imparts in the font fullness to the accomplishment of innocence. In confirmation gives an increase of grace, and not only an increase, but an increase after a wonderful manner. This the scripture is beautifully expressed by a metaphor taken from clothing. Stay you in the city, said our Lord and Savior, speaking of this sacrament, until you be clothed with power from on high. If pastors wish to show the divine efficacy of this sacrament and this, no doubt, will have great influence in affecting the minds of the faithful, it will be sufficient if they explain what occurred to the apostles themselves. So weak and timid were they before, and even at the very time of the Passion, that no sooner was our Lord apprehended, than they instantly fled, and Peter, who had been designated the rock and foundation of the church, and who had displayed unshaken constancy and exalted magnanimity, terrified at the voice of one weak woman, denied, not once nor twice only, but a third time, that he was a disciple of Jesus Christ, and after the resurrection they all remained shut up at home for fear of the Jews. But, on the day of Pentecost, so great was the power of the Holy Ghost with which they were all filled that, while they boldly and freely disseminated the gospel confided to them, not only through Judea, but throughout the world, they thought no greater happiness could await them than that of being accounted worthy to suffer contumely, chains, torments and crucifixion, for the name of Christ. Character of soldier of Christ. Confirmation has also the effect of impressing a character. Hence, as we before said of baptism, and as will be more fully explained in its proper place with regard to the sacrament of orders also, it can on no account ever be repeated. If, then, these things be frequently and accurately explained by pastors, it will be almost impossible that the faithful, having known the utility and dignity of this sacrament, should not use every exertion to receive it with purity and devotion. Ceremonies of Confirmation. It remains now briefly to glance at the rites and ceremonies used by the Catholic Church in the administration of this sacrament, and pastors will understand the great advantages of this explanation, if they revert to what we already said on this subject under its proper head. The anointing of the forehead. The forehead, then, of the persons to be confirmed is anointed with sacred chrism, for by this sacrament the Holy Spirit infuses Himself into the souls of the faithful, and increases in them strength and fortitude to enable them, in the spiritual contest, to fight manfully and to resist their most wicked foes. Wherefore it is indicated that they are to be deterred by no fear or shame, the signs of which appear chiefly on the forehead, from the open confession of the name of Christ. The sign of the cross. Besides, that mark by which the Christian is distinguished from all others, as the soldier is by certain badges, should be impressed on the more conspicuous part of the body. Time when confirmation should be conferred. It has also been a matter of solemn religious observance in the Church of God that this sacrament should be administered principally at Pentecost, because on the day especially were the apostles strengthened and confirmed by the power of the Holy Ghost. By the recollection of this supernatural event, the faithful should be admonished of the nature and magnitude of the mysteries contained in the sacred unction. The slap on the cheek. The person when anointed and confirmed next receives a gentle slap on the cheek from the hand of the bishop to make him recollect that, as a valiant combatant, he should be prepared to endure with unconquered spirit all adversities for the name of Christ. The pacts. Lastly, the peace is given him, that he may understand that he has attained the fullness of divine grace and that peace which passeth all understanding. Admonition. Let this, then, serve as a summary of those things which pastors are to expound touching the sacrament of chrism. The exposition, however, should not be given so much in empty words and cold language, as in the burning accents of pious and glowing zeal, so as to seem to imprint them on the souls and inmost thoughts of the faithful.